Actually, I wish we could switch viewpoints because this is really an amazing movie. Yeah, so this is Thorsten. I'm one of the general chairs of VR 2018. And yeah, I'm happy to welcome you all to the conference banquet. I hope you all like the conference so far.
Professor at the University of Stuttgart's Institute of Contemporary
control, engineering, machine tools, and manufacturing units. So far, the official bio. Let me now spend two or three sentences which are more private, so please allow me a personal comment here. So actually, it was in the early 90s, so in fact about 25 years ago, where I visited the famous CeBIT fair in Hannover and watched Oliver doing a demo with quite some fancy virtual reality equipment. And I thought to myself, this is exactly what I want to do for the rest of my life. So maybe Oliver isn't really aware of that, but in fact it was the starting point of my career. I don't know whether I should be thankful or whether I should say he's guilty. Yeah, I should be thankful in the end. So, Oliver's talk has the title 20 Years of VR in Industry, Pioneers, Enablers, Applications, and some vintage metal. So, welcome Oliver, the stage is yours. Maybe once more. Oliver, I don't see him right now, and the slides are not up, I don't know what happens here. Oliver, the stage is yours. Give him a big hand. Let me have a look where Oliver is. He's supposed to be here.
Let's see. It was announced to do something about 25 years of the VR industry. I believe you can talk about that, can we?
I think we can.
Okay, so let's try to do it. So, vintage material, vintage metal, a little bit. 25 years of VR, pretty much time. So, we have to give a warning. So it's restricted material. So everybody in the audience with less than 20 years of VR research might be offended a bit. So hands up with more than 20 years of VR research. Okay, you will see a piece of your history maybe. So all the other ones, don't blame us if we hurt you. So if you think 25 years, that's the age of VR, I have to tell it's not. So the initial, and I believe you have not even been born in 1965. I am. There was in 1965 somebody, some people might even still know, it's even Sutherland, he declared an ultimate display. And you can easily read what the display was supposed to be. And the display looked like it was made, sword of Damocles, but it was the first HMP.
Seriously.
Stereoscopic display using CRTs, 6-degree field tracking. And the only pity for my belief was that the content looked a little bit simple. And it took some more ages before this simple turned to something really with content. And to make it a real content, you all know that, you need some, let's say, metal, but you need as well silicon. So let's talk about a little bit about the pedigree of, let's say, computer graphics. So if you look really, really back, and you can see there was something like a geometry engine. And we have this kind of paper metal here. So my first machine was this twin tower here. Unfortunately, he put it somewhere in the cellar and we didn't find it anymore because he owned so much vintage computer that we put this crimson here. But let us tell you a little bit about the stuff. What is it all about here?
So that was what's the transformation stage in the OpenGL pipeline. It's now all crammed up in just this GPU, so that's...
And if somebody is around from a Deutsche Forschungsgesellschaft, so we spend in the early 90s for this kind of board, which normally you place in the oven to put a cookie on, we spend approximately 200,000 Deutschmarks for this plate.
But that's all, because then you need still draw some pixels, so the restoration stage, that's one of the boards making up the restoration. Mm-hmm. So you need at least two, and going up to four. So.
And let's talk about the CPU as well. So you need three boards, and we will talk about the content you can get out of three of these boards a little bit later. But as always in pedigrees, the kids grow while the kids shrink. So in this case, we had some pretty good shrinkdown process to come. The next one was this one here. And when this period was over, they put the covering and placed an espresso machine in there, but it's called Indigo.
I mean, that's a much nicer case than all these dark
things. It is. And now we have here another one. It looks a little bit like a toaster. And the good thing is, experienced people can do the comparison between three metals and one.
Just this one.
So this was happening between some years. So that was a shrinkdown process. There was some other process ongoing as well. The shrinking down is one thing, but you can solve all these problems brute force as well.
Yeah.
So there was a stage where people scaled up the computer. What was this all about?
I think they did just use one computer for every pixel. That was really great. So they made pixel flow made 100 megapoliers.
Something like that.
Second, that's still a big number today.
I believe one of the famous ones there was the so-called Henry out of Chapel Hill. Working with that one here. And the good thing is, if you sign a decent NDA with HP, they showed you the machine in the labs in Fort Collins. They did. So this is about computer graphics to use, let's say, even satellite display to have some content. But that was not the way history happened. So let's see what other stuff do we have here on So you can see, most of you know the crazy man in the upper left. He's doing music plus VR, that's Sharon O'Neill. And one of the first systems was the VPL, Reality Build for 2. And this, ladies and gentlemen, is the first commercial available HDD.
Does anybody remember how this was called?
iPhone, but it was way out before Apple called it iPhone. And you see it even shrink down a bit.
But that's the original one.
That's the original one. I don't know exactly the series number, but pretty much stuff in here. This was here, we need the camera again to show the details. So they just went at Price Electronics. They just went at Price Electronics and bought two Sony Walkman, placed it in here, Fresnel lenses, 6-degree of freedom tracking, remember that? Electromagnetic with a lot of latency. So cyber sickness was invented in these days. And you can see you can use it with two people. And again, we
raised up the machine from a desk side to a full-blown system, and in these days this was called Skyrider, but it was machines with two graphics systems, so it means six boards, so it means 600,000 Deutschmarks to spend to get two simple displays driven on an HMP here. So that's pretty good stuff. And a lot of these HMPs have been around, and it was like, everybody brought out an HMP, even silly stuff you can use for gaming.
And that was such a just an unusable. You didn't see anything in that box.
And talking about resolution, it was like 320 by 280 at best, and no color and whatever. But nice looking picture. So let's see what else do we have. Ah, yeah. The next stage was the so-called flight helmet. And this is a pretty good one. Maybe you can vary for a second. So again, LCD displays. And this is protecting you about any risks you can experience with VR, like downfalling, cyber sickness, or whatever. It's really hard stuff.
It's
really safe stuff. Really safe stuff. So, people always claim these days about megapixels. So forget about megapixels. We had megapixels in the past as well. And this is the next version we'd like to show you. You have to wear it as well. So, one of the key performance indicators here were pixels per kilogram. It was so outrageous heavy. So outrageous heavy. But it was a see-through. So augmented reality was even better these days. So then somebody showed up at the stage as well. Because if we talk about pixels per kilo, so there was a company called Fake Space, not Fake News. Fake News are from Flatland. We talk about 3D, so Fake Space. So you can see the weight is even worse. But there's a nice trick from physics, which is counterbalance. So, and inertia tracking, delay 3, brilliant. Mark, where you are? You're here? Woo! We don't talk about the costs. The only thing is, once we bought such a boom, he invented a device called Push. That's a boom without the wheels. Same price. So, that was, let's say, the story about the boom, and there was a great era. But still, being lonely in VR is such a sad thing. So, let's first talk about content. And another funny measurement that's real was polygons per second. So in these days, we always counted polygons. And that was the reason why even Sutherland had such a silly picture, because he had to count lines. So we had to count polygons first. The color space was not that deep, so you all have been at the Fraunhofer I.O. yesterday or the day before. But this is the basic entrance area here. Well, I have to take my Chinese lasers. This was the entrance, and we had to cut down the polygons to get that rendered at decent speed. So we used it for interior design as well. We used it for biological simulations and for interior work. And yeah.
Yes, it's the guy.
I think that's a keynote. That's a keynote speaker, Thorsten Specter, I believe. So I don't know the guy. But he was in the early 90s working in the VR as well. So, okay, that's content stuff. And being lonely, I mentioned it, being lonely in VR is boring. So then we had to talk about, let's say, the larger displays. But the most important stuff of this invention here was that women came in the VR research. So, cave women. And people like Bethany, many of you might know Carolina worked in that area. This was the age of screens, and we had, once in a sudden, we had totally other, let's say, devices. So we had to use special glasses.
Anybody remember the typical gesture of using this thing?
yeah. Is battery up or not? But when he was running, it was pretty good. And it was the first time they did a choice, the same product in two different colors, black or skinny. And skinny, by the way, we forgot to mention something, interaction. Interaction in these days was always something like a glove. And I heard about a keynote about haptics, which was happening this afternoon. So haptics is boring. Also, we had haptics as well. So haptics, or let's say it was haptic feedback, is this cyber glove with this nice little engines here vibrating when you touch something. Very good feedback. And I'm very sorry, the old ETL glove is gone. It will not last for 25 years, so the fabric is not as good as the rubber. So, this was about cave technology, and this was a breakthrough. So, what we see right now is that many people are buying cave stuff, and we have this nice cave here. This is owned by Thorsten, and Thorsten, I'm very sorry for that, it takes too long to helicopter to Aachen. So in 10 years we will have a VR conference in Aachen and we can show you the next stage cave. But we put it here to many car companies, and I believe Peter Zimmermann is around here, he worked with Display Technology at BMW. All the other car companies did it as well. It was in the US, in Japan, a lot of caves have been around these days. So everybody was happy, big machines. It was not that easy, but they have to sell now complete systems. Meaning, complete systems, a computer, you need a screen, and this was the age of the system integrators. And we mentioned here this nice little hardware coming from SGI, and SGI switched over to solution business. And what they sold reality centers. So that was the age of the reality centers, where we really could see that the combination of computer hardware and software makes it. But something else happened, yes.
Yeah, I mean, all these big boards, someone took them. They brought up just managed. It was NVIDIA first who managed to put all this into one single graphics card, and so we moved on from the reality monsters to the PC clusters, and so the whole thing became much more affordable, and this was
just make the comparison. This was worth 600,000.
This 600.
Or 600.
Max.
So, and we had PC clusters, price came down, content came up. A lot of content was now available. Content like shiny cars. We will see that tomorrow in the keynote, how shiny a car can be these days. And then we need a huge computer to make it really shiny. We had airplanes, we had ergonomic studies. Oh, we had nearly everything, I believe. And the polygon count was not an issue anymore. And so we started working on big data, so this buzzword which we know from these days. We started working about big data, and then we put, let's say, CFD data. And Ulrich and Uwe around here, you might recall what we did in these days, that we covered the Cray computer, used for, let's say, very powerful computing tasks, and displayed the results here in the cave. Or we talked about plant simulations. Or what did we do? What else did we do? So now, 25 years are not over, and then something happened in 2012. And you all know that the HMD comes back. So what is it now about?
I think it looks pretty much like what VGA did in those old days. So
it's not on Sony Watchmen anymore,
before
is it?
Before they spread to Watchmen, and now they just used a Samsung Galaxy Note or what, and built some decent HMD out of that. And so this became the next big thing, the next big step, because now the whole thing became cheap enough and usable enough so that.
So now it's 600,000 down to 600, 100,000, or was a bit cheap, okay? down to a smartphone. And this was breakthrough for applications. So what's up with industrial applications these days now?
And so, yeah, now, I mean, for many things, we all knew that many types of applications, we found that it works, that it would work, once we just would have some kind of hardware, some kind of devices that's cheap, that's easy to handle, so we don't need administrators and everything. And so now many of these applications can just be rolled out to the world, so it becomes accessible for many people and really can get out of the niche of just a few people having the chance to work with that great VR application technology.
So, but what's about this problem with the single view? So I have seen some presentation today talking about multi-view VR, that just sell it as a really new stuff. I believe we talked about vintage metal, so we had it in the past as well. So I take the lightweight, I take the heavy one. It was again this company, Fake Space, so which developed nicely the glasses. I don't know how many of them have been sold, but it was pretty good. So these have been special glasses in a special box and a special price. And we have been able to use it really for two people looking at the same screen with two different pictures and two perspectives. And Fake Space was based in California, and some other people have been based in California as well in these days, working in Stanford on multi-view VR. And just guess who that is? Here's a man with an arrow. Yeah! It's about that he is displaying in the show floor what he's doing these days, and this is much different from this one here, but these have been the first steps in multi-view VR. And again, 96, 97, don't talk about multi-view is new. It's better, but it's not new. So, what's next? So everything is shrink down, everything is cheap, content is there, what's next?
So I think at some day we should get rid of these projectors, needing so much space and always changing the lamps, and still, yeah, the images are somewhat right, but...
Sorry, Marco.
I mean, you'll come up with results, don't you? So, just replace the projector with many, many, many small LEDs. If we really get them small enough, then you just notice the grid anymore, and so you just need much less space, it's brighter, so it uses more contrast. So that's going to, I think, change.
And computer's down, HDD's down, nice displays, projector's down. Everything solved?
Not
everything
really.
Solved? Maybe not. So if you're talking about now 25 years, or to be honest, it's now 52 years of VR, if you take all the steps in between, remember ultimate display and so on. We both believe still being in VR, so this rated, restricted view we have here is pointing out some stuff you all have to work on in the next 25 years, or maybe you can do the next 2 years. What is definitely, we need 180 degrees, see through HMD, very low rate. So my dream is 100 grams would be ideal, it's like my real glasses. Haptics, mm-hmm. We had that keynote in the afternoon, we need haptics, because we only see in VR, or we can touch, but we need real haptics. We need avatars, we need social VR, we have to obey all the factors, take care about that. If you are too long in the virtual space, you need these as well. Finding your way in a virtual world is always a little bit tricky, because you use a paradigm to move around, sometimes the cables are not long enough, or what else, or the space is off. And we need some more applications.
Just the application that people just use, love to use every day.
So we can say being in the VR business now for 25 years, some of you are as well. All the VR researchers, please work on the topic.
It's a great time.
Great time.
Great time to work on this.
Enjoy VR research. Enjoy the evening. Thank you very much.